Hello, everybody, and welcome back to a very special podcast. This is the podcast in which we talk about all of your favorite TV series from yesteryear and then discuss them over a glass of wine. I'm Patrick M. Dunn, and perhaps you know me from the previous 100-something episodes, Ooga, and I'm joined here, as always, by Kat Halsted, the author.
Hello, everybody.
Welcome. Good morning. You've been up all night. You pulled an all-nighter. And
I did.
You texted me at like 9 a.m. my time, which would have meant it was 7 a.m. I was like, what the fuck is this bitch doing awake?
Dude, at like 5:30 in the morning, I was taking like voluntarily. A shower. I've already washed my hair, bathed, shaved, all that good stuff.
Yeah, so we're gonna get like lack of sleep cat today, so who knows what she will say.
Yes. I'm on my second cup of coffee, so that means I'm gonna be like hyped up on sugar.
About 30 minutes into the episode, you'll probably just crash and fall asleep.
I legit might, like,
I would have to finish off the Christmas Cavalcade 2017 all alone.
I know. That would be so sad.
I need your help and guidance, too. Because
we're doing one of the greatest TV shows ever!
Yes, and this might be a backdoor pilot, too. This is
it could be, yes. Set the Tone, the ER podcast.
Yes, based on the wildly popular series, ER, which ran for like 97 years, seemingly.
15 seasons, 1994 to 2009. Come on now.
That's a long time, though. That's a long-ass fucking time.
It is. And it's a lot of episodes.
Yes, cast changes.
Oh, a lot of cast changes. And there are definitely some seasons that are hard as fuck to watch.
Which seasons? Because I'm not too familiar with the show.
Basically, any season that does not have John Carter in it, so later seasons.
Okay. When John Stamos is on?
Actually, you know what? John Stamos is actually, I enjoyed him. He kind of brought my interest back because I was kind of like going, oh my God, I just got to get through these episodes. I know Carter comes back. I got to get through these. I just got to get through these because I did that crazy, insane binge watch this last summer.
Yes, so did you watch the whole thing?
Yes, I watched the entire thing.
From beginning to fucking end?
Yes, from beginning to end. I have seen every episode.
Well, get ready, folks, because she's about to do it again in 2018.
I am.
All right, so what episode
did... If anybody wants to sponsor Set the Tone, please contact us at info@saltyrockmedia.com.
Yes, or tweet us at Very Podcast, and we will gladly...
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you just offered, I didn't quite hear you.
Sorry.
All right, so what episode did we decide to do? Where are we heading to tonight? What era of the series are we dipping into?
We are going in season 2, so still pretty early on. We've got all the original cast, and it is the Christmas episode from season 2 called... Miracles Happen Here.
Yes, and this is not the first Christmas episode, right? Season 1 had one?
I believe so.
I only know because I almost watched it by accident. And then I was like, oh shit, I don't think this is the one I'm supposed to be watching.
There's one, but it's not as memorable as this one, I think.
Yeah, because I know we talked about doing the one where Carol has to go upstairs and like sing Christmas carols to like the recovery floor. And as I started watching the episode, I'm like, this isn't happening. I'm like, where does this come into play? Because I know I've seen this episode before, and I know it kind of happens early on when they start talking about it.
Yeah.
And so I was like, oh, shit. So I went back, and I realized that I'm watching the wrong episode. So that would have been the second time in the history of the show that I watched the wrong episode.
Yeah.
Which happened to me during the Girl Meets World episode, I believe it was.
Yes.
Do you have the air date of this episode of ER?
Give me just 1 second. I had it up.
I have it. I thought you would have fucking had it.
I have other stuff going on.
All right. So this episode aired on December 14th, 1995. We are in the mid-90s. The end of the mid-90s. We're now dipping into the later half. So are you ready for this wild night of television?
I am. I'm so ready to know what else I was watching this evening.
Glancing through this list, I definitely know what I was watching. And I kind of remember the other stuff being on as well.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a Thursday night. ER was always on a Thursday, I believe. I don't think it ever left its cozy 10 p.m. slot.
It was a nice... staple. Yes.
So do you want to start things off with the alphabet, ABC?
Yeah, tell me what was on ABC, because I know I probably was not watching that.
All right, I was not watching this show this night, but I definitely used to watch the fuck out of the show. An all-new episode of The Commish.
Okay.
Did you ever watch this?
My mom watched it.
Yeah, it was a very older person type show, but for some reason, mm-hmm. I remember I went on a ski trip with my grandparents, and they watched an episode, and I was there. I was probably like 8, 9, 10 or something. And I was like, oh, I kind of dig this show. And I followed it for a few months, maybe even like 2 seasons. But For those who are unaware, The Commish, it stars Michael Chiklis, and it's an American comedy slash drama that focused on the work and home life of a suburban police commissioner in upstate New York. And Michael Chiklis has hair in this show, too. He's not like that famous bald Michael Chiklis.
Wait, he had hair still?
Yes. So, hot scoop on Michael Chiklis. His character, Tony Scully? Scully, I forget. The character was at least 10 years older than Michael Chiklis in like real life age at the time. So the network was just so worried about him looking not the right age. So they insisted that he not shave his hair because he used to always shave his head because he was balding. Yeah. And he kind of had that weird like George Costanza kind of thing going on.
Mm-hmm.
In real life, he used to shave his head. And they're like, you cannot fucking do this.
Okay.
And then he started getting like fit. He started like losing weight. And they were like concerned about that. So they used to actually like ask him to like stuff his clothes to like make him appear like puffy. They wanted him to be like Chief Wiggumish, I guess, maybe.
I just remember like I had a girlfriend in middle school who The Commish was like her favorite show. Like the rest of us are all like Friends or ER, and she's like The Commish, and we're like, you're how old?
It was a weird show because it was a cop show, but it also had like humor in it. So it actually kind of had like, I'm trying to think of another show. It's not too like zany like Brooklyn Nine-Nine, but maybe like sometimes Murder, She Wrote got quirky.
Yeah.
It was kind of like that. And I just remember an episode, though, like there's one episode one time where like Michael Chiklis' character gets arrested, but he's like the commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
So like they put his desk in the jail cell and he was like in there just doing work while he was in jail. It was great.
Awesome.
Shout out to The Commish. I'm going to find you. I'm going to find an app.
Okay.
I'm going to introduce you to it. You probably won't like it, though. Or either that you'll fucking love it. You'll be like, oh my God, the fucking Commish. I love you. I love you, Michael Chiklis.
Oh my God, I have to fangirl over this show like 20 years later.
You'll be like shipping her, Michael Chiklis and like the lady cops on the show. Are you ready to move on to ABC's 9 p.m.?
Hit me with it.
All right. A two-hour block carved out a special. Frank Sinatra, 80 years my way.
Ooh.
I guess it was his birthday.
Wait a minute.
His 80th birthday.
I feel like I just heard something about this on the AJ Benza podcast.
Probably. I'll give you kind of like a quick summary of it. So it's Old Blue Eyes' 80th birthday celebration,
mm-hmm.
a star-studded event with tributes by a diverse company of guests and songs closely associated with Sinatra sung by groups from the early days as well as to like rock and roll to the 90s. So it's basically like kind of like a living legend being toasted by legends in the musical world. Mm-hmm. And you want to hear some credited cast members who made appearances?
Yes, please.
All right. Paula Abdul.
Okay, yeah.
Danny Aiello.
Okay, yeah.
Our gal pal, Roseanne Barr. I don't know why she was there.
This is totally...
Tony Bennett.
Totally what AJ Benza was talking about on his podcast that I just listened to the other day.
What was he saying? Because I didn't listen to this episode yet.
I don't... Oh, he was just talking about how like he and Nancy Sinatra used to be friends. And, like, she got him into, like, a good seat at, like, his birthday special thing that aired on TV.
Oh.
And now, like, she has him blocked on Twitter.
Oh, Nancy Sinatra follows me on Twitter. I don't know why. I love it. I love that, like, fun fact about
myself.
That
is so random.
Every, like, 3 months, I just go to check just to make sure she's still there. And she's still there. It still says, like, follow you right next to her name.
That's so wild.
Oh, yeah. Want to hear some other wild names that are on this?
Yes. Go.
Tony fucking Danza was there.
Okay, that makes sense. That makes sense.
Does it?
Yeah.
Was he like a big crooner for Frankie, old Frankie boy?
Yeah.
Angela Lansbury.
Okay, yeah.
Gregory Peck was still alive, so he was there.
Holy shit.
Salt and Peppa.
Okay.
And I got two more names, and they're TV stars. Paul Reiser, our friend Paul Reiser from Mad About You and Stranger Things now.
Paul Reiser!
And?
What's the male equivalent of a gal pal?
I don't know. I was like, bro... What rhymes with bro?
Okay. We'll come up with it, because all I want to say is bro-ho.
How about boy toy?
Boy toy? Okay.
Yeah, our boy toy, Paul Reiser.
Yes.
And I'm saving the best for last. Straight out of the 80s, his mustache, we know and love him, Tom Selleck.
Dolphin squeal.
Yeah, dolphin squeal. Dot wave. All right. And I'm sure this fucking special was awful. I probably would have not been interested in this at all.
Yeah, I totally would not have been interested in it back then. But there's this part of me right now that wants to go look it up on YouTube.
I know. I just want to kind of see like how like
disastrous. Like I want to see what it looked like.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of Frank Sinatra, and like I don't know, just from like what I know from him now, he just seemed kind of like a dick.
Like I like Guys and Dolls, but I mean it's also a musical where you get to see Marlon Brando sing. So
shout out to that. All right. Are you ready for some CBS? The Tiffany Network?
Yes, what was on CBS?
They called it, is it the Tiffany Network? Is that what they call CBS?
Yes, that's like why they call it. And I'm going to be honest. I have tried to like find out why it gets called that. And I like cannot find an answer that makes like sense.
No, I listened to another TV podcast and they said the Tiffany Network one time. And I was like, why do they keep fucking saying that? But it sticks with me, though. I don't know.
Yeah.
Like AV Club always says it.
Yeah, I can't find a correct answer.
At 8 p.m., we get a 2-hour block of Murder, She Wrote.
Wow. Okay, this is a wild night of TV.
Yeah, so the first hour is a brand new episode, a season 12, the final season, and followed by a rerun. So the new episode tonight that aired was Unwilling Witness. And are you ready for the plot line?
Give it to me.
It doesn't sound that excited. After being subpoenaed to testify at the jury probe of a brokerage house, Jessica is charged with contempt for speaking to a witness who was later killed.
No freaking way.
You mean she's connected to someone who got murdered? What?
Jessica Fletcher, girl.
Shocking. So we're in the final season. We're in the final year of Murder, She Wrote. So the previous season, they moved the show from Sunday to Thursdays, where it got like annihilated by must-see TV, the NBC lineup. And it lost a lot of viewers. I think we talk about this in the Murder, She Wrote episode. I found out the number, though.
Okay.
They lost 6 million viewers. 6 million viewers.
Holy crap.
And the show went from like being in the top 20, top 10 to being like not even top 60. Like it barely cracked top 60 something.
Damn.
So CBS was like, "All right, we're pushing you into the we're pushing you over the cliff. You're gone. Sorry, Jessica Fletcher." But they brought her back for the last 4 episodes aired on its like cozy Sunday night slot. I guess they just wanted to let it gracefully pass away surrounded by loved ones.
It's like, here's your 60 minutes lead in again. Maybe you'll get that boost. They'll be like, oh, hey, here's my show.
Grandma's who's been sitting at home for the last like season and a half has just been wondering, where did Murder, She Wrote go?
There's my Murder, She Wrote.
Yeah, she checked every Sunday night and she was just about to give up. And she flipped back over after the 60 minutes clock tick and stopped. And there she was, Jessica Fletcher, for her final mysteries. And they probably sucked, let's be real. Like, I think they aired in the summer. It wasn't even like during the season. Like the show like ended its run in August.
Oh, they did Angela Lansbury dirty there.
Yeah, but they brought her back for like a few movies though, so
That's true.
They undirtied her for a few nights. Are you ready for what was following Murder, She Wrote?
Yeah, what was on after Murder, She Wrote?
All right, and I always forget the show was not always on Saturday night. 48 Hours.
I keep forgetting that too, because you know how much love 48 Hours.
Yes, we know and love it. I actually found what the episode title was, but for some reason, I can't locate a summary of any 48 Hour episodes like pre-1998. It's like the show didn't exist before 1998.
That is crazy. Are you sure? Have you looked at CBS All Access to see if that episode is still there and available?
I haven't gone that far, but like I keep going to these TV databases, and it has the name of the episode. It was called America's Mission, but there's every other season has a summary, and you get like what it was about. But for some reason, like pre-1998, nothing. You don't get any summary. So I might check CBS All Access maybe later. And we'll do like an added show note. But we're in 1995, so I'm thinking Dan Rather was probably still doing appearances on the show.
Was Dan Rather at CBS?
Dan Rather was definitely on at one point, wasn't he?
I honestly don't remember what network Dan Rather was with. I guess it was CBS, wasn't it?
Hold on. Let me do a hot Google search right now.
Okay.
All right. Hot scoop. Dan Rather made 56 appearances on 48 minutes between 1988 and 2001. So he definitely could have been on there at one point during this year.
Okay, so Dan Rather was at CBS. Oh, that's right. I guess he was at CBS because then they got the whole scandal.
I didn't really follow 1990s news too much, though. That's kind of like an enigma.
Well, it's kind of like, okay, because Dan Rather was CBS, Tom Brokaw was NBC, and Peter Jennings was ABC.
Yeah. So, I mean, he definitely would have been on 48 Hours. It's not like they're going to put him on, like, Dateline.
Yeah. Well, because that's a totally different network.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Like, they're not going to cross-pollinate with their, like, news magazine type shows. Because, like, they will always bring in, like, the news people sometimes.
Yeah.
All right. Are you ready for Fox.
Fox, give it to me, give it to me. What was on a Thursday night? What could it be?
I was probably watching Fox because I was a Fox fan. So things started off at 8 p.m. with a holiday-themed episode of Living Single, which is still on. I watch this sometimes. It's on a weird-ass channel, and it's on every two episodes every night. And I watch it maybe like once every 2 weeks.
I've caught it here and there on some random channel on cable, and I'm like, oh, okay, I'll check this out. Because, I mean, Living Single is a pretty good show.
And it holds up. It's pretty wild. And some of the issues they deal with are, like, kind of fun. And,
yeah.
I don't know. It's a hot night. Tonight's episode was a holiday-themed one. The gang takes a trip to the mountains for Christmas. And Overton is disappointing when a mountain ranger doesn't let him keep up with his family's Christmas traditions. Ooh. Poor Overton.
Aww.
Yeah, poor guy. I just saw you yawning. Is your coffee wearing off?
Here, let me have another sip.
Are you ready for Fox 8:30?
Okay, what's on at 8:30?
All right, I don't remember the show, but I'm wildly intrigued by this show. A show called The Crew.
Okay, you got to give me more information because I totally know nothing.
I'm guessing this is probably like one of those Fox shows that are only on for like 4 weeks. It was called The Crew. It was created by Mark Cherry.
Okay, that's interesting.
Yes, who eventually went on to do Desperate Housewives and Devious Maids. Was he Devious Maids?
Desperate Housewives, Devious Maids, and GCB.
Oh, yeah. Shout out to GCB. Good Christian Bitch. What was it? What was it so far?
Good Christian Bitches.
Oh, yeah. And it was like based on a series of books, I think, or a book.
Something, I don't know.
All right, so anyway, The Crew. This follows the lives of a group of flight attendants working for the fictitious airlines, Regency Airline. And are you familiar with the actress Kristen Bauer?
That name sounds familiar, but I'd have to, like, see a picture to know.
All right, she was in this. You may know her as Pamela from True Blood.
Yeah, no.
Okay, and she was also Maleficent on Once Upon a Time.
Yeah, no.
Shout out to Kat not knowing who Kristen Bauer is. I can't believe you've never, like, dabbled into True Blood or even, like, seen clips of it by accident.
No, I have seen parts of True Blood. It was one of those shows you would be flipping through the channels and all of a sudden you stop on it and it's like, oh, hey, sex scene.
Yeah, she was the lesbian vampire who worked at the like the vampire club. She was kind of recurring in the first two seasons, and they like made her like a full time cast member.
Yeah, like I gave it a try. It was just a little like too much sex for me.
But she just recently popped up in an episode of Amazon's Lore, which I have yet to see. So I don't know. I'm intrigued by that show too, but haven't quite got there yet. I'm still going through episodes of Sybil right now. That's more important. Are you ready for Fox 9 p.m.?
Yes, let's go.
All right. So I didn't watch the show a lot, but I did see Epps. New York Undercover.
Okay.
This was a police drama that aired on Fox for 4 seasons. And hot scoop, I never knew this. It was created by Dick Wolf, and it takes place in the same universe as Law and Order, I guess, and now Chicago PD World or whatever it's called.
That means it also takes place in the same universe as Homicide: Life on the Street.
Yes. So the world just got a little bit bigger because now 4 years of New York Undercover is included in this. This starred Michael DiLorenzo and Malik Yoba as undercover cops in New York City's 4th Precinct who are assigned to investigate various crimes and gang-related cases. And it's notable for being the first police drama to feature two people of color in starring roles.
Okay.
So I've seen this a few times. I didn't watch it all the time because I think I'm going to be watching NBC this night, and you'll know why in a minute.
Yeah, I have a few guesses why.
All right, so NBC, are you ready for the old Peacock?
Yes, give me the Peacock Network.
This is a power year for NBC Must-See TV. This is probably their best lineup for a while. NBC kicks off with 8 p.m. Friends.
Woo, what episode did we have this evening?
The one with Phoebe's dad. Do you know this?
Ooh, okay, yes.
Do you want the official TV Guide summary?
Yeah, give me the official one.
All right, Phoebe, who is hoping for a Christmas family reunion, travels to upstate New York in search of her biological father.
Yes, she takes the cab and she's got Joey and Chandler with her, but instead of finding her dad, she finds that he walked out on his second family and she has a younger brother, Frank Jr., played by...
I don't know. I don't know this. Drop a name.
Giovanni...
Ribisi?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Shout out to Giovanni Ribisi. I didn't, like, watch too much Friends. I only really started watching it when we started doing the podcast, and we, like, occasionally do eps.
Oh, my goodness.
Are you ready for NBC 930?
830.
I'm sorry, NBC 830. Yes. All right. We've talked about the show numerous times in the podcast. The Single Guy.
The Single Guy. Jonathan Silverman.
Yes, the two-season wonder, Jonathan Silverman, and it follows his life as a struggling writer in New York City, I think.
Yes.
And his pals, who changed, like, from year to year because they just kept retooling the fucking show.
Yes.
Olivia Diabo popped up in season 2. You may know her as Kevin Arnold's hippie sister in the Wonder Years. And Dan Cortez, I think, was one of his friends for a short while, right?
I think possibly so, yes.
Pre-Veronica's Closet Dan Cortez, post-MTV, like, rock and jock. MTV Sports.
Sorry, hold on. Got a little hot in here all of a sudden.
Have you ever seen the final episode of The Single Guy?
Probably, but I probably don't my memories of The Single Guy are very fuzzy.
All right, well, here's some hot goss on the final episode of The Single Guy. They knew the show was going to be ending. Like, I guess they must have, like, preemptively filmed the final episode. So they have Jonathan Silverman's character goes off to Vegas and gets married. And thus ends his single guy status.
Ooh.
And connecting the NBC sitcom universe even like further together, Ross Geller actually appears in the episode.
Yes, there's a crossover. That's one of the things I remember is that like Ross starts hanging out with this guy. And then I think the guy kind of gets fed up with Ross. But Jonathan Silverman and David Schwimmer went to high school together.
Oh, okay.
Where John Ingle, who played Edward Quartermain on General Hospital in the 90s until his death a few years ago, was their theater teacher in high school.
Oh, wild, wild stuff. So what is the NBC sitcom universe? So it's Mad About You, Friends, The Single Guy, Seinfeld.
I think Caroline in the City, possibly.
Okay, well, it's coming up. Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert.
Are you ready for NBC 9 p.m.?
Yeah, 9 p.m. What's on at 9 p.m.?
Seinfeld! Do you know the episode The Gum?
The Gum?
Yes.
You mean the one with the gumball machine and they drug the woman so she falls asleep and they play with her toys?
No, that's not this episode. This is the one where Lloyd Braun gets Jerry.
Oh, this is the one with the like the creepy weird Chinese gum that Jerry doesn't even like, but he can't tell the guy he doesn't like it because it'll like set him off into like the nut house or something.
Yeah, and not just the guy, Lloyd Braun.
Yes.
Lloyd fucking Braun.
That
you're like the guy. Yeah, so this is Seinfeld. It's season 7, I think. We're getting close to the end.
Yeah.
Things are starting to unravel a little bit, but we still watched it. We didn't care. We loved it. NBC 930. We teased it a little bit and I kind of spoiled it. Caroline in the City.
Oh, Caroline.
Leah Thompson. Howard the Ducks, Leah Thompson.
Caroline and Richard, I've over the summer because CBS All Access has Caroline in the City episodes.
Yes.
I watched a few. I went and I watched the like finale because I was like, I don't remember how the show ended. And I watched it. I was like, what the F? This is how it ends?
How does it end?
So it did not have a super satisfying ending.
I don't think I've ever seen the end of it.
Caroline and Richard are engaged. But it turns out he had a baby with his ex-wife.
Okay.
And he, like, goes to meet the baby and he decides to, like, stay in Italy and be a dad. And he and Caroline break up. And then she, like, falls for some other guy right away because it's Caroline.
So they're definitely probably, like, ramping up for, like, a reconciliation in the next season. And it just never takes place.
Well, because this is what happens. She's like about to, it skips ahead to her like about to marry this dude. And Richard has like come back and he's got the kid and he wants to be with Caroline. Like, I guess he got custody or something. And he finds out she's going to marry this other guy and he goes to the church and Caroline's about, he's like in the back and Caroline's about to say her vows and the baby starts crying and Caroline turns around and fades to black.
Oh, so I'm guessing the show was produced by CBS, right? If it's on CBS All Access?
Probably.
So NBC was probably like, you know what? Let's just like create one of our own shows and we don't have to pay for like the rights for the show anymore. Sorry, Leah Thompson. Your Caroline is out there just waiting to find out what happened.
Yep.
I think I'll get over it. All right. 10 p.m. We're now going to stroll into the main event. I love when like the show that we're going to do ends up being like the last show. Like,
in the lineup.
So shout out to ER for being the last show in the lineup. A miracle happens here. The classic season 2 Christmas episode. I think it's like episode 10, season 2, something like that.
Yes, it is. Something like that, yeah.
All right. So do you have any quick like ER general overview info that we can kind of guide us into the episode?
Okay. It takes place at County General.
In Chicago, right?
Which is the county hospital in Chicago. It focuses mainly on the ER doctors and nurses and
supporting staff.
Yeah. In this episode, we have Randy as our clerk, who dresses very provocatively. Let's see, anything major. At this point, Dr. Green is in the middle of a malpractice lawsuit.
Yes, I was kind of confused by that added plot line because I'm not familiar with it.
In the first season, he had a patient come into the ER who had some symptoms that could be one of two things. Either it's just like a bladder infection or it's preeclampsia.
Oh, and she gave birth, right? And then she died.
Yeah, and I feel like it's one of the best episodes of ER. Oh my god, you like Love's Enduring. Oh my god, it's such a good episode. Like, holy crap, it's one of the best. It's the first like standalone focuses on like one character kind of thing. Oh, it's such a good episode.
So we deal with like the trials and tribulations of Dr. Green going through dealing with all the attorneys.
Yeah, like he's just like, it's just like a regular day at the ER, and there's this whole situation where like he keeps trying to get her up into the OBGYN wing, but they're full up. So he's like trying to deal with her down in the ER, and just, it's just like anything that could go wrong on this day does. Like, she can't push the, like the cord gets stuck around the baby's neck or something, so he has to do an emergency C-section, and it's just everything that could go wrong goes wrong.
Yeah, so when he's now, like, we flash forward to this particular day, and he's dealing with the lawyers, and they want him to settle, but I guess it kind of leaves a bad mark on his record, but it's good for the hospital.
Yeah, it's better. It's good for the hospital, but it's not good for Mark, and because basically a settlement says, yes, I did something wrong.
Yes,
I mean,
the hospital's fine because they don't have to spend as much money, but he kind of is like, you know what, I think I did the right thing, and he wants to see it through to the end.
He's like, I did everything I could, and in all honesty, like, I've seen, like, I really do feel like it was just bad timing. Just, like, everything that could go wrong went wrong.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of life. I mean, people come into the ER, and you can't save everybody, unfortunately.
You can't always just send them where they need to go. There's never, like, that's a you like when we do go through and watch ER, you will see that like half the time these patients can never get to where they're supposed to be.
Yes. So I work in an emergency room. So yeah. It's the, you know, they want to move patients up to the floor upstairs, and there's no rooms available. And sometimes they sit in the ER for hours, and it's just, they need to get them somewhere, or they need to transfer them somewhere, and the transport vehicle's not here yet.
Yeah.
Or they, you know, they're waiting for a helicopter to fly in, but there's red tape, and the place where they want to send them to isn't accepting anybody right now. So it's hard.
Yeah.
And, you know, you also have like other stuff coming in, like gunshots and cardiac arrest. Mm-hmm. And then you get like fucking stupid things. Like people get like sore throats, and I don't know, they like cut their finger on a fucking kitchen knife, and it, like, the bleeding stopped 5 hours ago, but they want to get it checked out. So, you know, you gotta send people over there to check on that, and it's crazy. So like being an ER staff member is stressful.
Yeah.
And it's rewarding, but it sucks. And poor Dr. Green just went through the ringer.
Dr. Green is not only dealing with the medical malpractice lawsuit, he also, like in the episode before, found out that his wife has fallen in love with another man and is cheating on him and wants a divorce. So Dr. Green is having a shitty holiday.
Yeah, and then like he's dealing with like a pretty like hefty situation in the emergency room too. We're kind of like jumping around a little bit, but
yes.
There's a woman who I guess gets carjacked.
Yes, she gets carjacked, and she's an older woman. She is a Holocaust survivor.
Yes.
And she's injured. She's been carjacked, and they discover that her granddaughter was in the car, and she's freaking out because she doesn't have the baby with her because, like, she had passed out from the injuries from the carjacking. And so the carjackers dropped the baby off somewhere.
So, like, the carjackers took the car, and they probably were, like, halfway down the street and realized there's a baby in the back seat, in a car seat. And they're like, oh, fuck. And they just had to, like, take her somewhere.
Yeah, they just, like, drop her somewhere.
Yeah. So they just, all they wanted to do was just, like, steal the rims off her, like, her Cadillac. And it's like, oh, shit, we have a baby now.
Yeah, exactly.
Now we can deal with this baby. And the grandmother, she, like, suffered some, like, minor injuries. Nothing, like, major. But, like, she didn't, like, care about her injuries at all, which is, like, very powerful.
She was all worried about the baby.
Yes. And it was kind of like a spiritual moment for Dr. Green, too, because as you teased, this woman was a Holocaust survivor. And she kind of, like, pushed religion out of her life following her time in the concentration camps. And she hadn't prayed, I think she said, what, in like 40 years or something. Like, I haven't prayed in 40 years.
Yeah.
But she had like some religion in her life, I guess. Just she kind of kept up appearances for her family.
Yeah, she kept up like the whole like traditions and, but you know, it's like one of those things you kind of go through the motions. You don't feel it, but now she feels it.
And she finds out that Dr. Green is the son of an agnostic Jew and someone who is Catholic, but does
a lapsed Catholic.
A lapsed Catholic. That's what they said. So he basically is not religious at all. He's like a man of science. He's like, he's just focused entirely on medicine and science. And
yes.
I guess together they find God in this episode. They both pray.
At least for the moment. They find some solace.
I can't imagine Dr. Green, like probably a few days later, he kind of had to move on to the next stage of his life. Probably like forgot all about this incident because, you know, things just come into the ER at all times.
Yeah, exactly.
And he just moved back onto his agnostic lifestyle.
Okay, so then we have Carol... Nurse Hathaway, played by Juliana Margulies.
Yes, my favorite. She's my favorite on the show. I love The Good Wife. I love her. And she's been like in tons of TV shows over the years, too. And yeah. I think I've watched all of them. Like anytime I see Juliana Margulies is on something, I'm like, oh, I'm like, this is going to be, you know, this is going to be good.
Yes.
Her wig collection.
So this is back. It's the 90s. So she's got like that pitch black hair. That, like, grungy black hair.
Curly slash messy.
And Carol has bought this rundown house.
Yes.
She's got a new boyfriend who is a paramedic.
Yes. She obviously doesn't stick with him, right?
No, she doesn't. stuff happens later in the season where he's just too much of a mess.
I honestly didn't even know his name.
Shep. And he's played by an actor that you know, you've seen him in, like, a bunch of other stuff, but...
You can't place it.
So she's got this, like, rundown house. She's trying to renovate it. And it's the middle of winter, freezing cold outside. She has no heat. Her water barely works. And she's like, oh, but I want to spend Christmas here. And it's like, girl, your house is like barely four walls and a roof. Like, it doesn't even have a roof. There's a hole in the roof and a hole in the floors below it.
There's a hole in the roof. So it started snowing. So snow is actually coming through the hole in the roof. And it's snowing in her living room.
Yes.
And there's no furniture. It's not like there's a couch they can hang at and snuggle up at. Like, she's thinking that they're going to get, like, a Christmas tree. What? It's got to be, like, a really, really close to Christmas, like, a few days before, right?
Yeah, it's definitely a few days before because everybody's kind of in that panic. You hear it from the nursing staff. They're in the panic to get things done for Christmas.
They're already, like, plotting their Christmas party, the staff Christmas party. And they're talking about going upstairs to the recovery floor. And I can't imagine them, like, doing, like, going up to the recovery floor and, like, December 3rd and like singing Christmas carols. So it's definitely like the week of Christmas.
Exactly. Yeah. It's definitely like it's days before. At most 3 days.
And there's an older guy. He looks like Santa Claus and his last name is an anagram of Santa Claus. It's like Mr. Callis or something like that. John Callis.
His first name is Stan.
Stan Callis. Was that his name?
Yeah.
It's like all you have to do is just like move the L and it's Santa Claus.
Yes.
He keeps like dropping these weird little hints that he might be Santa Claus.
Well, he hand carves toys. He said he's been doing it for a million years. It's like really heavy handed. And Carol is just like that person who, I don't know, she just needs to like believe in something at this point, I guess.
Yeah, she's just that person. She's always been captured by the spirit of Christmas and she just wants to keep the spirit alive. And she probably, you know, she has a shitty house that she's living in. It's fucking cold. There's no heat. Her boyfriend kind of sucks. And she just wants to have like that Christmas. Like every,
yes,
you know, everyone.
So she's looking for something. She's looking to grasp onto something. And this old guy who's got a white beard, white hair, who makes toys and got cut with the carving tool is just the thing to like get her kind of going, huh? And then she like asks Mark who he looks, if he thinks he looks like somebody. He's like, oh yeah, he totally looks like him before he died. And Carol's like, wait, what? He's like, yeah, Jerry Garcia. And Carol's like, no.
He did not look like Jerry Garcia.
He did not.
I'm just going to throw that out there.
That's actually kind of what makes it really funny is that I kind of wonder if Mark was just messing with Carol at that point.
Mark had stuff on his mind. He was busy. And he probably just looked in real quick, just saw long gray hair and a beard and probably saw him from like the side or the back or something. It's like, oh, Jerry Garcia just went on to his patients because he just, I don't have time to stop and look at some guy who like cut his finger on like a whittling tool. I don't have time for this shit. Like, I'm trying to find, like, a missing baby.
He's like, I got, like, a ton of stuff to do. I don't want to, I'm trying to, like, keep as busy as I can so I don't think about the fact that my wife cheated on me. I'm getting sued for malpractice. My daughter's, like, in freaking Ohio and not going to be here for Christmas. So, yeah, let's not talk about the spirit of Christmas right now, Carol.
Yeah, sorry, Carol. I don't got time for you right now. And then, like, meanwhile, she's, like, stressing out because they're having the annual, like, Christmas carol on the fourth floor, the recovery floor. And I guess every department goes up to, like, make some kind of representation of themselves, and they go up and sing a song.
Or, like, I don't even know, like, because I don't think they do this in other seasons, so it was, like, something they did this year, and...
It didn't work out, so they didn't do it again.
I guess, like, you sign up to, like, oh, yeah, we're gonna go... It's like, okay, first of all, I'm sorry. Can you really expect the ER staff to be able to leave to go sing carols?
No, not at all. Not even close. No. Like, maybe two, like, people can go up. That's like,
maybe two. You can't just be like, oh, yeah, we can all go up and sing a few carols. Like, no. Like, okay, yeah, recovery maybe doesn't have anything else to do. So they hang out, they sing. But ER? Fuck no.
Spoiler alert, at the end of the episode... Pretty much the whole ER is up there singing Christmas carols.
Yes.
The whole episode, though, Carol's, like, trying to get her. She's, like, running up to all the characters, all the main cast, the recurring roles. And they're like, you're going upstairs at, like, 8. We're going to do the sing-along, right? And they're like, oh, I can't. I got this going on.
It's like, no, at 4? Nope, sorry. I'm leaving at 3. Bye.
Yeah, oh, I got to go pick up my son. And, you know, oh, no, I have surgery at 7. I can't do it. And, like, all this stuff. And she's pissed. She's getting pissed at everybody.
She's like, nobody has the Christmas spirit, blah, blah, blah.
So it kind of ties in with her her believable old Saint Nick plot line. And you're like, oh, like, it's all, like, coming together. So it's a weird, fun side plot.
Mm-hmm.
It ends fucking stupid. I think this, her subplot ends stupid. So at one point, she's about to finish up with Mr. Callis. And she has to leave for and do something for a minute because there's some, like, shenanigans going on down the other side of the hospital. We'll get to in a minute. But then she comes back just to, like, discharge him, like, give him his, like, papers. And he's gone. He's nowhere to be found. No one's seen him leave. No one, like, saw him walk out. The window's open a little bit. And then she's like, oh, that's weird. So she, like, closes the window. And she looks out the window and she hears, like a sleigh bell, like, taken off.
Oh, we forgot the best part. His wife and kids show up.
Oh, yeah. I forgot
about that. You know, she's got that Mrs. Claus kind of look going. And the kids are all, I guess the best way to put it, they're all little people.
Yeah, I was like, they're elves, right?
They're definitely not kids.
No, they were grown men, but they looked like kids.
So that, like, just kind of gets Carol going more like, wait, what is going on?
But as soon as they fucking played that sleigh bell, I was like, oh my fucking God. Like, what? Why did they have to do this? This is not... Like,
come on.
This is not like a Disney Channel show where they have to, like, reinforce the idea that Santa is alive. This is a show that's on at 10 p.m. on NBC for grown-ass adults. Like, a child will never sit down and watch this and think, like, oh, Santa's not real? Like, you mean to tell me that Santa is not real? No. Like, a child is not going to watch this show and pick up on that.
Yeah, like...
So, I don't know. I hate how they force Santa Claus down you sometimes. It's fucking stupid.
Santa Claus is real. Okay? Remember, dear Virginia, the bell still rings for those who truly believe.
You don't need to put this on shows that... Very well critically acclaimed shows that are based on reality. You don't do it, please.
Are you saying Santa isn't real?
Yes, I'm saying Santa's not real.
Oh!
Do we need to get the Phaeton couch right now so you can go pass out and...
Hold on. Yes, Cap Phaeton. Obviously, it must be a Christmas morning.
Yes, every hot scoop. Cat faints every Christmas morning.
That's not exactly true. I fainted last Christmas morning.
Just last Christmas?
That was the song that was playing.
All right. What else is going on in this episode? What is some other wild things that are going on?
Okay. Let's see. Oh, we've got the Peter and Carter situation.
Yes.
They're up in surgery because they are technically in the surgery department. But Peter is the one who gets sent to the ER. So Carter gets sent to the ER. Because Carter is his student under him.
Yeah, so Carter is in his fourth year of medical school at this point, I believe you told me.
Yes, he would be in his fourth year. He will graduate at the end of this season. All
right, so he's starting to do a lot more. They actually, like, now sent him to talk to the patient's family to, like, get signatures and stuff and consent.
So he can explain the procedures. And Carter is very good at talking with people, as we see in this episode.
Yes, people like
him. He's personable. He has a bedside manner. Dr. Benton does not.
No.
Peter does not. And it's something that comes up quite a bit throughout the series, is Peter is not as personable as one might need to be.
Yeah, so well, sometimes you run into doctors.
Especially in emergency situations.
Yes, well, sometimes you run into doctors. They're really good at their job, and they can just go in. They don't have time to talk to you. They just want to go and get it done and get you out. Patients don't like that. They, you know, they want you to, for some reason, like, sit down and chat and be nice and bring you fucking crackers, and they don't have time for that. So it's, I guess, you know, they find someone who's, like, the face, someone who's good at that. And Carter is, he's young, right? He's probably, like, 25, 6, 7-ish at this point
in time. Probably, like, 25, maybe.
So he's really young.
I think.
He seems like he went to med school, like, really young. Like, he didn't, like, stick around for a while and decide when he was, like, 27 that he was going to apply. Like, I guess he must have been, like, fresh out of college and was like, you know what, I'm going to go to med school now.
Yeah, Carter went straight into medical school. There was no question about it for him because he had a brother. His brother passed away of cancer when he was young.
So he was on, like, a quest.
So Carter knew he wanted to go into medicine.
Yes. We'll get into it in Set the Tone, an ER podcast next year.
Yes.
So, you know, they send him off to talk to the family. There's this guy. He just needs, it's a risky surgery. It's something new that they...
It is a surgery that they're actually doing a study about at this point.
Yes. I believe one of the surgeons in this hospital, in County General, actually, like, pretty much, like, invented the surgery.
He invented it. He has taught it to several of these surgeons, including Peter. And they are trying to use it whenever possible. And then using the patients as part of the journal.
Yes.
That paper that they're going to write about it, explaining it to the rest of the world as a new innovative technique.
Yes. So the operation's risky. It's a 50-50 operation. So, like, it's not like, oh, you have a very good chance of it being successful. There's a lot of complications, and the numbers aren't good. 50-50. That's just like, all right, I might die or I might be okay.
Yeah.
Or
it's like flip coin.
Carter talks to the family. It's this woman. She had some kind of weird cardiac-related issue going on, something that's not too common.
Well, first we see Carter with – this is how we set it up. We see Carter – Benton is pissed that Carter didn't do something the night before because he was talking to a patient and their family and reassuring them about the surgery. And when Peter's like, no, you're going to go do the paperwork. Just go. Just get out of my hair. Because basically, half the time, that's what Peter does. He just tries to send Carter away. Like, he doesn't really want to teach Carter. He doesn't think about Carter. He doesn't see how useful Carter is to him and what he can learn from Carter.
Yes, and I guess there was a patient that wanted to, last minute, decided he didn't want the surgery, but Carter intervened and managed to change the patient's mind.
Yes, because the wife got scared.
Yes.
So Carter, like, kind of reassured her. He went over it again. And the other surgeons were like, Peter, you're so lucky you have Carter here who can do this because he's got this skill to talk to the people.
So he kind of realizes it. And strangely, at the exact same time, this woman comes in. She's having some – she just came in with, like, very severe back pain. It was related to some weird cardiac thing. It wasn't a heart attack. I forget what they said it was. It was the perfect opportunity to use this risky new surgical procedure. And Peter wants Carter to, like, talk the family into going forward with it. So, I don't know, he works his magic, and he's talking to the patient's husband, and it's an older man, he doesn't want to lose his wife.
Yes.
But he finds out, like, if they do the other surgery, it, you know, it might not end so well. And then the husband's like, oh, like, what would you do? Would you do this crazy new surgery?
I'm going to tell you something, Carter regrets this whole thing because this is an ongoing thing that happens. Is Carter being nice, says, oh, he gives the guy his pager number, page me anytime, and this guy is like on Carter, like he's calling Carter all the time. He's like asking Carter all this stuff all the time.
I'm picturing like Carter's laying in his bed. And he gets, like, a text, like, at 3 a.m., you up? You up, Carter?
Yes, pretty much. Like, he would get these pages. Like, he'd be in bed with his girlfriend, and his pager would go off, and it's this old guy wanting to, like, ask questions about the wife or just talk. And eventually, like, Carter's like, dude, I can't do anything. Like, Carter snaps, and he's like, I'm done. I can't do anything. Like, and the woman dies. Spoiler alert. So, this guy, I will just say that this old guy, like, yeah, he gets pissed at Carter. And when seasons later, when Noah Wiley left the show, one of his last episodes, this guy comes in as a patient and he's still pissed at Carter. And Carter is all like, I don't know who you are.
All right. So how does Carter's story wrap up?
You know, he talks to the guy, he gets him to agree to the surgery, and then later we see him caroling with Carol and the others and at the Christmas party at Carol's house.
Yes, things end swimmingly for him this week. Things go great.
After he gives his girlfriend the earrings.
Yes.
His girlfriend is played by one of your favorites.
Christina Lise?
Yes.
She's in this episode. She shows up a few times. We don't really get like a lot of time with her in this week's episode, though, unfortunately.
I'm going to be honest. Her character really, there's not much to her character.
She was on it for a while, but she was only recurring, right? She never like hit the main cast.
Yeah, she was just basically like a med student a year behind Carter, and they dated.
And then she leaves at some point.
Then she leaves to go back into the Army.
Oh, shout out to the Army. Yeah. So in this episode, I think she buys the errands and she's showing them to all the other female employees and just being like, oh, like, what do you think? And yeah. They're all like, wow, you like, I can't believe you bought these.
Yeah, Susan, this leads into the Susan storyline.
I love Susan too. She's my favorite character.
Oh, okay. I love Susan in her first run. They totally misused her later on.
Oh, okay.
But I blame Abby on that. So Susan is like the go-to for like, do you think my girlfriend's going to like this? Do you think my girlfriend's going to like this? Because Nurse Lydia's like boyfriend, husband, whatever he is at this point is like going, do you think Lydia will like these? And Susan's like, oh yeah, totally. This is it. And then Carter goes to Susan because I think she's like kind of woman you can trust. And you know, she's not going to like spill your secrets kind of thing.
Yeah. Do you, like, low-key, do you think she just always said
and
yes?
And she's not going to lie to you.
Low-key, do you think she always just said yes, like, do this?
No, I think if there was something really bad, she would say it.
She would say it. She had a Julia Stiles vibe to me. Did you get that impression?
Okay, yeah, I get that. I see it.
Like, when she first popped up on the screen, I was like, is that Julia Stiles? And I was like, no, Julia Stiles would have been way too fucking young to be on ER in 1995.
Susan, seriously, she's so good. The first original run, like, oh.
Well, we'll get to revisit Susan's run, and then she'll go away for a while, then she'll come back, and we'll hate her. Did she quit the show, like, on her own terms?
Yes, she left on her own. Which was so stupid. Because everybody else made bank.
Yeah, like, I don't even know the actress's name that played her.
And
do you know the actress's name that played Susan?
Yeah. Like, and she comes back later, but she doesn't get the good storyline she should have gotten.
What's the actress's name?
Sherry Stringfield.
Yeah, like you don't hear Sherry Stringfield and, like, think her wild career post-ER. Like, George Clooney is obviously, like, George Clooney. But even, like, Noah Wiley is... He had, like, that TNT show for a while. Gloria Rubin's on that show, too, I think. And, Juliana Margulies. She obviously went into The Good Wife, which was on for, like, 1,000 years. And has Anthony Edwards been in anything? I honestly can't.
Law and Order True Crime.
Oh, I didn't really care for that much, though. Like, we were going to do it as a special.
I didn't really care for it. Honestly, I got to the point, the only reason I was watching it still was because of Anthony Edwards.
Like, we were going to do it as, we were going to, like, cover the show as part of the podcast. And I got through, like, the first two episodes, and, like, I can't even go any further with this. Like, I love Edie Falco. I love her wig in this. But a wig will not make a show. Like, I need plot behind that wig.
Yeah, it was hard to watch. It was hard to watch. I honestly can't tell you which one was Eric and which one was Lyle.
And were they 40-year-old actors? Like, how old were the actors playing the Menendez brothers?
Yeah, they were like our age, playing like way younger. It was really weird. It was so weird.
It was just too much for me. I couldn't get into it. I would rather just watch like a stupid Lifetime reenactment of it with like Courtney Love as Kitty.
Yeah, I still have to watch that. And I feel like that would be like way better than. What I watched.
All right, and we have one more storyline. Speaking of Susan, she's kind of involved in the shooting that happens in this episode.
Yes, a priest gets shot and he's brought into the hospital, and like there are some of the kids from the neighborhood who are in one gang, and they're like he's like keeps telling them it wasn't the other gang, but they kind of don't believe it, and he's like dying, and he keeps saying it wasn't them, don't go out for revenge because it wasn't them.
I had a problem with this because if there's a shooting and someone comes in and they're like mortally injured like this, like they're on the verge of death, One, they're not going to let anyone in the room, like, while they're, or even, like, nearby. And if there was a shooting, the police will pretty much force the hospital to go on, like, a lockdown until they declare that it's okay. Because you don't know if someone's going to come in and finish the job. If that person survived, there is a strong possibility that someone's going to come in and finish the job. And then even, like, anyone who, like, checks in after that, like, they'll come in, people will come in, like, say, oh, like, I have, like, a cold, but, like, it could be, like, the killer. There's, like, a lot of scrutiny going on.
Yes, okay, so throughout the series, you will see that security in the ER grows.
Okay.
There is a point where Dr. Green actually gets, he almost gets murdered in the bathroom of the ER. Like, he's just there at the urinal minding his own business, and somebody comes out and beats the shit out of him. Like, it's hard to watch. And then there's also a psychotic patient who kills Lucy and stabs Carter. There's, like, something else, and Carter just finally flips, and he's like, God, like, Carter donates money to the hospital to increase security.
So this must be, like, maybe, like a 1995 relic of our past. Like, when we watched, like, Magnum P.I., and that airport had, like, no security at all. Like, you could just, like, walk through the gate. Yes. It was a military airport.
Yeah, it was a military airport.
And this is, like, people, like, coming in and out.
Public airport. You could just walk through with a gun in your pocket.
So, wild times in 1995. You could do whatever you want. It was, like, the wild, wild west.
It was.
Yeah. So, the priest ends up dying, and the gang is still insistent that, the rival gang did it. We don't really find out for sure. Like, it's possible that the priest was just, like, hiding, like, the shooter just to prevent, like, further violence. We don't really get that closure, but Gloria Rubin's character, what is she?
Jeannie Boulay.
What does she do? I honestly don't even know what she does.
Okay, she is a nurse practitioner, I believe.
Okay, so she's, okay. So she is put in charge of, I guess, talking to the gang members who came in with the priest. And she's just continuing the priest's word and, like, trying to, like, end the violence in the city. And so she just keeps going up to the gang members, and she's, like, talking to them and just being like, all right, you need to not retaliate this. Like, that's why we have the police force. That's why we have, like, an investigation is going to be launched. Just let them take care of it. I know this priest was your friend. He helped you out. But you don't want to throw away your lives, because next thing you know, you're going to retaliate. Then someone's going to retaliate against you. Or you can go to jail, end up in prison. It's just going to be an endless cycle. It's not going to end well. And I guess she gets through to them. I'm not really, like, we don't really get, like, a follow-up.
Well, I feel like she only gets through to them when she finally looks at them and goes, has the father ever lied to you? And they're like, no, he never lied. She's like, so why would he lie now?
And they instantly believe her, I guess.
And that's basically all Jeannie did in this episode.
I mean, they could have gone home and then changed their mind if they found out, like, more information. But at least for the course of, like, a Christmas-themed episode, we get closure. I guess we never see the gang again, so I guess things end up well. Like, maybe they went, like, that guy, the lead gang member, went on to be, like, a lawyer or something. Or, like, even, like, joined the police. Who knows?
Who knows?
Yeah, maybe he was inspired by Gloria Rubin's character.
Maybe if they had any more violence, they just went to Chicago Hope instead.
Yeah, they're like, you know what? Fuck this bitch. We're gonna go to Chicago Hope. Mandy Patinkin, help us. Oh, you know what? Like, in the... Maybe, in the podcast, the ER podcast, we can, like, just, like, make snarky remarks about Chicago Hope.
Even though we've never seen it.
I've, like, low-key, I didn't really watch much CBS in the 90s, so.
Honestly, I don't think I really did either.
I didn't even know, like, Chicago Hope was, like, a show until, like, 2001. No. When I was a senior in high school, we had to do all these, like, things, like, where everyone had to, like, write down, like, all their favorite TV shows and favorite movies and stuff. And I worked for the school's newspaper, and I did all these dumb interviews with, like, students, and we, like, would publish them, like, in our newspaper. And I remember one girl said her favorite TV show was Chicago Hope, and I was like, what the fuck is Chicago Hope? And I went home and, like, Googled it or whatever, Yahooed it.
You had to have or asked Jeeves.
Yeah, I asked Jeeves because it was 99-2000. I was like, what is Chicago Hope? And you got, like, you don't really get an answer. You just get whatever the IMDb page said, because there wasn't, like, Wikipedia, which gave, like, a full in-depth description of what Chicago Hope was.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, I just found the IMDb page and, like, a basic summary, and that was it.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, that's what Chicago Hope is. I thought it was, oh, it's like ER. Okay.
Yeah, it's like ER.
But it's not like ER. But the 90s was also, like, a wild time for hospital dramas, I think. I think that's when the genre really, like, took off and became serious and was not, Well, I mean, there was Saint Elsewhere.
Yeah, there was Saint Elsewhere prior.
But that was, like, really it, though, I think, right?
I think so, yeah.
Because I think, I mean, there was the show, what was the Aaron Spelling show about, like, the EMT? Was it called Emergency?
Yeah, but I don't think that was super serious.
No, that was, like, late 70s, early 80s. Then there was an actual show called, like, Emergency Room in the 80s. I think it even was on NBC.
Yes, which actually, starring Elliot Gould.
Yes, and it was more...
And George Clooney guest starred on it. 10 years before ER.
Yes, I remember reading that in TV Guide all the time, and I don't think it was like super serious either. I think it was kind of quirky in a way.
Yeah,
it was like 80s.
I believe it was actually like a sitcom.
And yeah, so there wasn't really like any like heavy hitting like medical dramas until the 90s, really. And like honestly, like ER is like the only one mm-hmm. that really like stood out until like Grey's Anatomy came out and like Private Practice.
And yeah,
honestly, to this day, it's like the only one that really still.
Yeah, stands like
out.
Okay, it's so funny is everybody thinks I watch Grey's Anatomy. Like people always just assume I do. And I'm like, no.
It was okay for a little while, but it was just not ER. And they had too many behind-the-scenes scandals for me to even, like, take any of these people serious.
Yeah, like, I'm going to be honest. I gave the first season a chance, but it didn't pull me in the way ER did.
Yeah, and you know, Katherine Heigl is not our gal pal. Let's just throw that out there. Not a gal pal. Frenemy. Frenemy of the show. Her and Candace Cameron. Frenemies to me.
Why do you hate my gal pals? They're my gal pals. I'm claiming them for me.
Ooh. All right. Well, you can have your shitty one season Katherine Heigl TV shows, and I will have my Good Wife. I don't think you watch the Good Wife.
I get 27 Dresses.
27 Dresses is not too. I actually like 27 Dresses. I used to like Roswell with Katherine Heigl. I actually enjoyed her on that show, but for some reason, when mm-hmm. she was on Grey's Anatomy and Grey's Anatomy like took off, she just I just felt like she tried to become like larger than life.
Mm-hmm.
I think I saw an interview with her one time and I was like, no, not for me. She's not for me.
I just remember she was always in like the gossip columns for something stupid.
Yeah, nothing. It wasn't anything like too scandalous either. It was just like lame stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, what is she up to now? Does she have a TV show coming out?
No, she's doing Kitty Litter commercials.
Oh, yeah. We talked about that. I forgot we talked about that in a previous episode.
Yeah.
She was trying to lobby to get herself back on Grey's Anatomy, but they're like, no, you're not coming back on Grey's Anatomy.
Like, yeah, I'm pretty sure Shonda Rhimes is like, oh, hell no, bitch.
Shonda Rhimes runs a tight ship.
Yeah, like, she... Okay, the one thing Shonda Rhimes needs to understand, though, is she writes a goddamn soap opera. Just accept it, lady. Just accept it.
She has, like... standards and practices that she abides by, and if she has to break it for Katherine Heigl, she'll have to do it for other people
like Patrick Dempsey.
But who knows, we might see Izzy again. We never know, because Grey's Anatomy, I don't know, that's been on for like 100 years also, so.
Yeah, that seriously, how many freaking seasons has that show had?
I think they're gonna tie ER. I think they're coming up to the tiebreaker season if not ready. And it probably will go on because
it's been on since I was in college. That's all I know.
Any last minute notes on ER? Anything that we need to warn our listeners about for set the tone? Is that the name of the podcast?
Do I need to explain Set the Tone?
I think you do. We'll explain it again in the first episode of Set the Tone, but we'll do it here as like a teaser.
So in the pilot episode of ER, Juliana Margulies' character Carol tries to commit suicide, and she's brought into the ER as a patient. The doctor who's actually in charge of the ER, played by William H. Macy, tells Mark that he has to set the tone. Because he is like the one everybody is going to look to for how to react and respond and treat this situation.
Yeah, so he's handing the reins over to Dr. Green. And it's kind of, yeah. ER starts with the beginning of Dr. Green's reign.
Yes, it's basically Mark becomes...
head doctor? Like, what is he? Director?
He becomes the... resident, like, oh god.
We'll come back to that. We'll come back to
that. I forget what it's called. But then Mark is dying of brain cancer because it's just there's nothing else they can do. And he realizes that he's leaving. And he doesn't...
Hey, spoiler, Kat.
Spoiler alert. Sorry. He doesn't really say goodbye. He doesn't announce that he's leaving. And Carter's out at the basketball hoops. And Mark looks to him and he says, Carter... set the tone. And Carter doesn't get it right away until they find out that Mark has died.
Kat's crying right now.
And then Carter kind of holds on to that. And when Carter leaves to go to Africa, he sees Archie Morris outside. And Archie is drunk because Archie was a hot mess or high or something. And but there's There's something about Archie, though. He has a good heart. He really does.
Shout out to High Doctors.
And Archie is played by Scott Grimes. And Carter looks to Archie and he says,
"Hey, Archie. Hey, Archie, set the tone."
Or Morris. He probably calls him Morris. But yeah. And then,
"Hey, Morris."
When Carter comes back, while Carter was off in Africa before he comes back toward in the last couple of episodes of ER, Archie Morris grows into that doctor that Carter was and that Mark was. So even if he doesn't remember that Carter said that to him, he became that figure in the ER. And so now I'm crying.
Kat's crying. She just spoiled the entire series, so we don't have to do this podcast anymore. And
yes, we do.
She set the tone. The tone is set. Well, I'm sure people who listen to it, I'm sure people who will listen to it have already seen it, I'm assuming, so.
Yeah.
It's not going to be, like, too much of a spoiler. And it's been off the air for almost 10 years, so it's common knowledge at this point, I guess.
Yeah, it should be.
All right, so we're closing the book on Christmas 2017. The book is officially closed now.
Yes.
We have shut the book. We spent a Christmas in the hospital.
We did.
And it was sad and happy.
We have had a wild Christmas. What have we done? We have gone down the Hallmark rabbit hole. We've done some sitcoms.
Yeah, we did it all. We covered it all, I think. I think we did a sitcom, we did a Hallmark special, we did a cartoon, and we did a drama and a theatrical release. So I think we did it all.
Yes, we hit all our favorite things.
Yes. So what are we doing next week?
Next week, we are doing a Disney film.
Yes. So this is a late edition.
Yes. We made a change to our schedule.
Yes. So a few episodes back, we made reference to it in the He-Man and She-Ra episode.
Yes.
And we weren't sure if it existed in any medium. We weren't sure if we could find it. Literally, an hour after we recorded the He-Man and She-Ra episode, I just went onto Hulu, and I wasn't even searching for it. It was on the page. I was on the main page as something we could watch. I was like, oh god, I am not going to sleep tonight, because now I have to watch this. So I stayed up late till like 3 in the morning, and I watched Disney's The Black Cauldron.
Oh my god.
The 1985 animated classic, which is pretty much, it almost destroyed Disney, like the Disney Animation Studios almost went under because of this movie.
It still hasn't made all its money back. It will never make all its money back. It's just, it would have to have such a resurgence to make its money back.
Yeah, so it only made like $24 million while it was in the box office. It cost like triple that to produce because it was using like wild new animation techniques, mm-hmm. Computer animation and stuff. It was like still like new at the time. Disney worked on this movie for like 10 years and they worked on it forever, and they just couldn't get it right, and they just kept going back and, like, starting over, and they finally, like, got down to it in 1985, they released it, like, test audiences thought it was too scary, mm-hmm. so they had to, like, redo some of it, and it was just a hot mess, and it did so poorly that they never released it on video after the theatrical run. I don't think, it was, like, 1999 when you could finally actually, like, get it on VHS. And maybe it came out on DVD. I don't even
know. I think it came out on DVD like another 10 years later or something.
Yeah, like 2000, late 2000, like 2008 or 9 or something like that.
Yeah.
And then for some reason, they put it on Hulu. Hulu like scooped up the rights.
Okay, so Hulu also has The Fox and the Hound.
Yes.
Because I watched that last night with Axton. And then it has The Rescuers, The Aristocats. It kind of has that weird era.
So Disney kind of branched away from like princess and prince and like fairy tale type movies for a little while. And they're good movies, but they're just not classics, I guess.
I would say they don't have that same oomph, say Sleeping Beauty or Cinderella or The Little Mermaid or Beauty and the Beast. They don't have that kind of power.
Yes. And I believe Little Mermaid was like the resurgence of that in 1988 or 89, whenever that came out.
It was.
That kind of brought Disney back into the forefront. But we'll get into it and in more. We'll go deep for the Black Cauldron up, I think. I think we're going to get all the
Yes, I haven't watched it yet. Okay. So.
So it's really weird. It's super weird. I'm going to let you know. It's kind of scary. It's kind of scary. And
so you're saying I should have a boy over to grab onto.
Yes. I think so.
When I get scared.
Yes. The voice acting's awful, I'll say that. Okay. Most of the characters suck. The pacing's kind of weird. But you know what? Low-key, I still love it. There's like a charm to it. And you can kind of tell they cut out a lot of stuff when you're watching. You're going to, you know what? You can tell there should have been more. Because I read the books. It's a series of three books, and I think the Black Cauldron is like all three books in one movie.
Ooh.
And it's like very rushed.
Okay.
Like they didn't Lord of the Rings it. They didn't like do like a movie for each book. They just pushed it all into one book.
Yeah, they didn't Hunger Games it up or Twilight it.
Yeah, well, that wasn't like known back then. You kind of like sense like there's a rushness to it, and they like squeeze it into like an hour and a half movie. We'll get into it.
Okay.
But check it out on Hulu. Heather, you're going to like shit your pants when you hear this announcement. We already told you, actually.
Yeah, actually, Heather knows.
I had to tell her. I was like, you know what?
Sorry, Ryan. Heather got scooped.
All right. Heather got hot scooped by us. Hot scoop. Of
sorry,
the
Stephen.
We're ending the year with a hot scoop.
I think Heather knows, and I think a certain boy knows.
And you know what? Maybe we'll send Ryan a carrier pigeon with this announcement because he doesn't have social media. So I'll write it on a little like little post-it note. We'll wrap it around like a crow's foot, and we'll send it off. Hopefully it gets there. Who's closer to Ryan? Is it you, me or you? I think I'm closer to him, right?
I think you might technically be closer.
I'll send it off to him. I'll go outside right now and look for a crow to send it off.
Okay.
Or like, what do they send off? A pigeon, a carrier pigeon.
Yeah,
like a crow.
Pigeon.
All right. So I'll be for the next hour. If you need me, I'll be outside looking for a pigeon. And Ryan will get this message in about 2 months after the episode comes out.
Yeah, two months later, a pigeon will just like land on his car.
Where can you follow us?
You can follow us on Twitter at @VeryPodcast. You can find us on Facebook and Instagram at @AVerySpecialPodcast. Do not accept imitations. You can find us online at averyspecialpodcast.com and at saltyrockmedia.com.
Yes.
And of course, you can search us on YouTube, A Very Special Podcast.
Yes, I don't, I think there'll be a link to it on the website, but I don't know how to specifically find it on YouTube, but just search for A Very Special Podcast. We have most episodes on there, most of the new ones, and I'm slowly adding the old ones.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of working on the edits a little bit. And as always,
bye!
Watch the carrier pigeon in the sky.